And we're back. This is a Middle Perch Live on the internet. I am MTKMIC, and today we're going to read two reports from the border of the United States with the nation of Mexico. The first one is from 2006. That's 13 years ago. And the second one is from this year. And both are by two of the United States' greatest contemporary writers, George Saunders and William T. Volman. You can look them up. We're going to begin with George Saunders' piece from GQ magazine, published in December of 2006. And then we're going to proceed to William T. Volman's piece in just a month ago in Harper's magazine. And we're going to see what these two writers thought and what their discoveries were. If it's possible to respect the reports of anyone from there, I would hope that these two men would be considered reasonable. So let's begin with The Great Divider. Part one, stand back, Mr. Dobbs. Let me handle this. Once upon a time, there was a wealthy country. Just to the south was a poor country. Between them ran a border. People from the poor country were always sneaking over, trying to partake of the wealth of the wealthy country. The people in the wealthy country resented this. Or some did. Some seemed fine with it and even helped them once they got here. Some said it was a crisis and a big wall was needed. Others said, what crisis? It's been going on for years, plus they work so cheap. You want to pay $9 for a freaking quart of strawberries? The national media seized on the story and, as always, screwed it up. Reduced it to pithy sound bites, politicized it, and injected it with faux urgency until, lo, the nation was confused. Then a man, a writer, me, actually, decided to venture forth to find some answers. Was it a crisis? Was all this excitement justified? Might terrorists someday come in across the border? Was the border really rife with drug-related crimes? I went, boldly, driving from Brownsville, Texas, to San Diego, California, armed with the ancient tools, objectivity, open-mindedness, a laptop, a rented minivan, a Chrysler Town and Country, to be exact, with electronic everything, including rear and sliding side doors. So as our story unfolds, please imagine these doors periodically sliding, flying open in the middle of epic southwestern landscapes for no reason at all, or simply because I've tried to change the radio station. Part two. Go to jail. After eight times, go directly to jail. In the temporary detention center at the Laredo North Border Patrol Station, a Mexican kid slumps in a chair at a processing desk. He's going to jail for at least 3 months because this is the eighth time he's been caught illegally entering the United States, and the system's patience has finally been exhausted. Border Patrol Agent 1 runs a hand shyly over his new haircut, which is nearly a buzz. That's the, I don't understand that haircut, says Agent 2, wearing a huge cowboy hat. At least he's got hair, says Agent 3, and Agent 2 blushes, acknowledging it. Yes, yes, it's true. Under this hat, I'm bald. I point to my own head. We all laugh at my hairline. Then I look over at the kid. He's sitting there expressionless, a small cat among large dogs. And now he's got to endure this balding talk, this nervous braying laughter before he can get to the next enjoyable step, being processed, and on to the part where he gets sent off to a foreign jail. My heart goes out to him. Sort of. Because empathy depends on how you've spent your day. I just spent mine driving around in a marked caged unit with Agent 3, a.k.a. Dan Garibay, visiting the muddy clearings where illegal aliens change into dry clothes after they cross, inspecting fence cuts, driving past safe houses, hearing agents talk about tracking groups of illegals for 11 straight hours. I've learned that it's now more profitable to traffic in humans than in drugs. That MS-13, a Salvadoran gang, is in a death struggle with the more traditional Mexican mafia. That Border Patrol agents in Laredo are routinely shadowed by spies from the smuggling cartels, who in turn are shadowed by a newly formed counter-surveillance unit. My relation to this Mexican kid, then, is something like that of a plumber's apprentice to a leak. Dan's third-generation Mexican-American, a funny, reasonable guy who seems to be constantly considering and reconsidering the moral implications of his job. He's got nothing against illegal aliens, understands why they do what they do, has compassionate feelings toward them, and seems committed to catching them in a way that keeps them safe and leaves their dignity intact. But the law is the law, and why should those who break the law be privileged over those who've played by the rules? So I find myself thinking regarding this silent, sullen, unrepentant kid, this member of Wascals who insist on trying to elude my new friend Dan. Dude, what did you expect? 7 times? Who doesn't learn after 7 times? Do you value your freedom so lightly? Do you have a wife, kids? Do you realize that you're now going to miss the next 3 months of their... Then, imagining that he has kids who look like little Mexican versions of my kids back when they were toddlers, I finally experience a little heart pang as I flash on what I'd been thinking, what I would be thinking if I were him. Laugh it up, you balding bastards. I'm dying here. Can't you tell I'm a decent person? Oh, Jesus, please let me go. Just this one last time. They're so cute and will never be this age again. Please, please, I've made a terrible mistake. And what will you do if we let you go? I ask him in my mind. Will you try to get in here again? Next time you could be looking at 5 years. He hesitates, averts his eyes. Seriously? I say, my God, is it worth it? Are things really that bad where you live? And he just looks at me as if to say, would I keep trying it if it didn't make sense to keep trying? If the possible reward didn't justify possibly getting caught? Do I look stupid? He doesn't look stupid. He looks handsome and sad and ashamed. But mostly what he looks is busted. Busted and waiting to pay the price. Part 3, Hustling for School Books. I cross the bridge into Nuevo Laredo, quote, the most dangerous city in North America, close quote, according to Dan, with an African-American long-haul truck driver from Kentucky who's wearing a cowboy hat and a shirt with a flag sewn in the back. For 13 years now, whenever he drives this route, he's parked on the U.S. side and saved a few bucks by getting a cheap hotel on the Mexican side. He's divorced, but his wife's a good lady. She's kept him on her insurance. She's a nurse, and a good nurse, not a slut like most nurses who like to fuck the young doctors in the rooms where they keep the towels. Do I know about this? Am I aware of this phenomenon? In the most dangerous city in North America, a guy's getting his shoes shined with an air of 1950s satisfaction. A row of old people are fingering their pants legs on a bench. A toddler's doing a happy skipping dance along the lip of a fountain. Not so bad, I think. A town like any other. Do I want a girl? A boy? A boy from Boys Town? A young guy's fallen in beside me, Hector. No, man, I'm married, I say, happily married. Isn't it the case, he says. When a man goes with another woman, the wife will give him such a... How's it called? He mimes slapping himself. Slap, I say. Your woman will give you such a slop, he says, shaking his head at the memory of the last time his wife gave him a slop. Hector advises me, stay in the shopping area. Do not err to the left or right of the bridge. Avoid the police. Two gangs are fighting for the town, each with its own cops. The cops you see have money. They'll plant drugs on you, take your money, possibly kill you. Times are hard, he tells me. Fewer tourists are coming all the time. His daughter just graduated first grade, but they haven't been able to afford the books yet. He didn't see his family last night, not having the $5 necessary for the bus ticket to León. I give him $10. He accepts with surprise, gratitude, some disappointment maybe. It's too little money, too early in the night. He tells me nostalgically about the first time he sneaked into the United States with his uncle in 1989 in a little boat. His dream is to go over again soon and join his brother in New Orleans, making $15 an hour doing post-Katrina work. He knows about the location of the new checkpoint on Highway 83, which I visited with Dan earlier today, and how to circumvent it. Get dropped off before the checkpoint, walk a couple of miles around it, get picked up on the other side. Not easy, I say. Yes, easy, he says. And even easier if he had an American to help him. Do I have a car? Is my car parked in Laredo? If I drive him through the checkpoint, they won't even stop us. Ha ha ha, I think. Hi, Dan. I can explain. A muscular, scowling guy, face heavily tattooed, strolls past with henchmen. Hector, distracted, alarmed, trips on an exposed pipe. He doesn't like me, he says, because I'm with you in his area. His area, I think. The street comes alive with creepiness. This is the town that killed its own police chief on his first day in office for pledging to end the drug trade. I should probably head back, I say. I think so, says Hector. Soon the bridge is in sight. Suddenly he's nervous, abashed. Maybe I could give him a little something. I remind him of the $10. That was for my children, he says. I'm asking now for me so I can buy a hot dog. Over the next few seconds, I, one, am annoyed at his nerve, two, castigate myself for being so tight-sphinctered over, what is it, $2, and three, hand over the money, smiling warmly to hide the fact that one and two ever occurred to me. Hector steps away, buys a hot dog from a vendor, disappears down a side street, raising the hot dog in gratitude. I cross the bridge. Easy for me, I think. Impossible for you. Back in the United States, the facades are nicer, the traffic lighter. My nation appears in that moment as a very clean, anxiety-clenched fist, in the grip of which I feel comfortable and happy, like myself again. Let's take a pause for some music.
Whoa! Push on through. Whoa, Lord, I got to keep on moving. Lord, I got to get on down. Lord, I've got to keep on moving. I've been accused on my mission. John knows he shouldn't do it. For handing me, they were willing. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And that's why I've got to get on through. Lord, they're coming after me.
Perhaps maybe you've heard some variant of the following. I have nothing against Mexicans, immigrants, those people. But nowadays you go to name of a city and all you hear is Spanish. It's as if these people, the Mexicans, the foreigners, expect me, us, Americans, to speak Spanish, adapt to their culture, kowtow to them. Whereas the burden ought to be on them, the newcomers, the Mexicans, to assimilate, right? Someday soon, you're going to find whole cities, American cities, full of people speaking only Spanish. Note to the speaker of the above, such a city already exists. Welcome to the Friday night party that is Laredo. At Shirley Field, Laredo Martin High is kicking the crap out of Carrizo Springs High before a huge hometown crowd that is virtually all Hispanic and dressed in school color red. The majorettes conclude their bit, march crisply into the stands per instructions with swift, precise turns, trying not to crack up. A Mexican-American princess, up, up, and away, reads her t-shirt, searches the crowd, rendered confident and in love with the world by virtue of her beauty, assisted in her search by a heavier, less elated girl. Show of hands, I think. Anybody here can't afford school books? Ha ha, no way, the crowd roars in my mind. Are you joking? We have SUVs and PlayStations and plenty to eat. We roam the earth expecting respect and receiving it, for we are the American middle class. And we shall live out the full measure of our days amidst happiness and plenty. I leave the game early, have dinner at Taco Palenque, a kind of Taco Bell on glamour pills, tonight inexplicably overrun by gorgeous Mexican-American women in tight designer jeans with glittered eyelids and balletic hairstyles a la Princess Leia. As has been the case all night, only Spanish is being spoken unless English is needed. In which case, English is delivered gladly, genially, and unaccented. Tonight, America seems like a happy miracle, a land o' plenty where a new ethnicity is being created, an ethnicity that transcends the Anglo-Hispanic distinction, and the primary mascot of this ethnicity is affluence, accompanied by its beautiful sidekicks, civility, humor, kindness, and relative absence of fear. Tonight, America seems like the for centuries dreamed of rescuer of the little guy, the place that takes a guy like Hector and puts some pounds on him, sets him on his feet, puts a spring in his step, and ends forever his flinching hustle for $2 hot dogs. But first, he has to get here. Among the Mennonites. The East Texas countryside rolls by, ranches, elaborate memorials for car accident-killed Mexican-American boys woven into barbed wire fences featuring silk roses, and in at least one case, the small plastic figure of a professional wrestler. It's been unusually rainy, and treetops jut eerily up from a temporary lake, in which it seems hobbits should be fishing from little bark boats. In Roma, the World Birding Center overlooks a small Mexican village from which I can hear the ringing of someone's old-fashioned phone. I'm driving from Laredo to Brownsville to meet with some Mennonites who work with the Mexican-American poor in the Rio Grande Valley. Many of the poor are, presumably, undocumented immigrants. I'm feeling a little funny about meeting these Mennonites because I'm not sure I agree with what they do. If there's a law and they, even inadvertently, help the undocumented circumvent the law, doesn't this just encourage further lawbreaking, which in turn reinforces the system of law circumvention, which in turn strengthens the illegal smuggling cartels, thus ratcheting up the cycle of high profits, violence, and chaos that Dan Garibay described? Egads, I think. I am becoming Lou Dobbs. Later that afternoon, I'm standing in a circle of pretty young women, Teach for America workers at a Mennonite church social in San Juan. It's muddy and sunny. The music's about to start. Across the two-lane is a tract house neighborhood a la Spielberg. Nearby is a movable free-range chicken shed and an organic garden and a donkey named Pierre, rescued from a neglectful owner by the pastor of the church, John Garland. John looks more like a guitarist in an indie rock band than he does a pastor. And his wife, Abby, looks more like the beautiful vocalist in that band than she does a high school teacher pastor's wife. John has started a model organic farm here at the church. The idea is to help underprivileged workers access the intellectual capital of their work. Immigrants are often expert organic farmers who, if they happen to be undocumented, get stuck working for other people, underpaid, or cheated of their pay. Around them, John and Abby have gathered a group of similarly well-educated, young, politically engaged volunteers working with the poor in small towns across the Rio Grande Valley. What have they seen? You name it. Blonde Spanish-only speakers, mothers who call the school to say they've been deported but will be sneaking back in time for parent-teacher conferences, families in which the kids speak only English and the parents speak only Spanish, families in which the parents speak English but the kids, recent arrivals, can't, kids who came over illegally as babies and are now fully acculturated American teenagers, excellent straight-A students who, because they are undocumented, can't get financial aid for college, which means, given their family economics, no college for them at all. So what do they do? They go to work, Abby says. John has told me that although their mission involves, quote, reaching out to those in need, some of whom in this area especially may indeed be undocumented, they don't have a clue if people have documents or not. Still, remembering my Lou Dobbs moment, I ask John and Abby if they ever have doubts about working with the undocumented, since technically it's against the law. John looks at me thoughtfully from behind his glasses. Absolutely, he says. Just the other day, these two guys walked up here and said, hey man, we just crossed the river. We're really thirsty. We need some water. And I looked them over and said, sorry, friend, you'll have to get up the road. Abby nods. So this is interesting. Yes, they are Christians. And yet they understand that the law forbids. Then they both crack up. Yeah, see that big cross on the front of the church, says Abby. That's actually what it means. Take it up the road, close quote. The thing is, when you read the Bible, John says, one thing it's not is wishy-washy about our responsibility toward people in need. Yes, there's the law, and we should respect it, but there's also a higher law, close quote. In Abby's opinion, the problem with this immigration debate is the level of abstraction at which it's conducted. If you talk about undocumented workers or illegal aliens, it's easy to make mistakes. Whereas if you say, this is Valerie. Valerie is my student, whom I love. Then whatever you do will make sense, coming as it does from the heart, with a real person in mind. The next section is called A Story Too Sad to Invent. Because of the way Lupe Aguilar's past has been described to me, I expect him to be mean and wiry and street-scarred. But no, he's white-haired, gentle, and articulate, with a quality of patient abiding that makes me instantly crave his approval. After church, at the head of a long familial table in a Mexican restaurant, he tells me he used to, one, run wild. His wife's sitting across the table and her eyebrows go up, indicating, oh yes, he did. Two, shepherd groups of recently arrived Mexicans into a hotel room, take his fee, and then rat them out to the border patrol. Three, own bars, party, and fight. A guy he offended once put three slugs on his back. Then he experienced a religious conversion and is now a Mennonite pastor who shelters the homeless in his house, in trailers behind his house, in the kitchen of his church. As we enter, a smiling, timid family just arrived from Veracruz rises as one, exclaims, mucho gusto, as one, sits as one. Or in the church itself, in the Sunday school rooms, in the sanctuary beside the altar, with a disregard for his personal space that I find impossible to imagine. Would I let strangers sleep in my home, at my work? Would I let a constant flow of unknown quantities stream past my kids? No, I would not. And this isn't just my paranoia. Lupe says people he's helped here have stolen from him. He's lost three cars this way, insulted him, made indecent proposals to his wife and daughters. He's not a big favorite of the neighbors either, some of whom consider him a lawbreaker. But he feels doing this work is his duty. Once, back in his early days as a Christian, a young Mennonite volunteer overheard him use the word wetback and referred him to Matthew 25:40. Quote, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me, close quote. Reading this, Lupe says he was changed forever. His goal in life is now, quote, to be humble and meek like Jesus, close quote. And you see this desire working through him in the things he does and the way he attempts to deflect credit. Quote, Jesus is the doer, close quote. To illustrate the way the current system of illegality creates secrecy and chaos, which in turn brings down worlds of shit, mostly on the poor, he tells me the following story. Once upon a time, a young couple left Mexico and came north. Trying to avoid the border patrol, they crossed the river in a remote area where they were set upon by border bandits who stole their shoes and money and raped the woman in front of the man. She became pregnant. Having become Christians and after much soul searching, the couple decided to keep the baby. But the woman's water broke at 5 months, and the baby died 10 minutes after its birth. The couple couldn't afford a coffin, so Lupe called in a favor from a funeral director. The funeral home allowed a brief 20-minute ceremony and donated a small cardboard box for the burial. Then the Mennonites acquired a small plot from the county and drove out in their own cars to bury the baby. At the grave, Lupe had to pry the dead baby out of the grieving mother's arms. The woman was a mess, but being undocumented, was too afraid to seek psychological help. In her heart, she blamed the man for not defending her, blamed herself for not being able to carry the baby to full term, blamed God for not helping them. The man, for his part, couldn't make peace with the way he'd failed to protect her. In the end, the pain proved too much, and the couple separated. The end.
I would never give the power to a morning. Run, come, crucify in a dress. Time alone, oh dear. Think you're in heaven, but you're living here. Think you're in heaven, but you're living here. Think you're in heaven, but you're living in hell. Time alone, oh, time is in. Think you're in heaven, but you're living in hell. After all, oh, not the brother, but the one who set them up, dying alone, oh, dying in. Think you're in heaven, but you're living in hell. Think you're in heaven, but you're living in hell. Think you're in heaven, but you're living in hell. Dying alone. Oh, think you're in heaven, but you're living in hell. Oh, oh, my in my world. Oh, my to the world. Oh, my in my heart. Oh, children, we know.
This next section is entitled, What Do We Want? Deport them now, in quotes. Let's meet the Rodriguezes, who came from a very poor Central American country and now live in somewhere, Texas. The Rodriguez males are legal, the females are not. Mr. Rodriguez came illegally, but has since gotten his paperwork in order. Their baby son was born here and so is a citizen, but the wife and daughters remain undocumented. I visit them in their home, which Mr. Rodriguez built by hand out of cinder blocks over the past 5 years. When not working his first job, laying tile, his second, factory watchman, or his third, growing their food in a backyard garden, the gray cinder blocks, arched doorways, and poured concrete floor give the house the feeling of a medieval castle, had the king driven masonry nails into the cinder block in order to hang some framed family photos. To get here, Mr. Rodriguez worked his way north through Mexico for 2 years, doing construction, learning local dialects along the way to avoid getting busted by Mexican immigration. He's a big guy, hearty and happy, somebody you'd see beaming down from a Diego Rivera mural, but his time on the road seems to have spooked him. He saw people shaken down, unfairly arrested, robbed, murdered. He saw, quote, lots of lifeless bodies, close quote, along the road. The real horror, he says, was in Mexico. For 2 years, his wife didn't hear from him. How did she feel during this silence? She suddenly looks physically sick, says she doesn't like to think of that time when she was sure he was dead. She was trying to keep the farm going, baking pan dulce in a mud oven he'd built, 100 small loaves at a time. Twice a week she'd walk into town, tray on her head, and in this way supported a family of five. Then came the earthquake. It ruptured the walls of their adobe house, and she moved herself and the children into a shed she built of 3 sheets of government-supplied sheet metal, which was just big enough for a bed and a table, and unbearably hot in the daytime. Then one day, a letter came from America. He'd crossed on an inner tube in a group with coyote help and lived briefly in a safe house that he left as soon as he found it was also being used in the drug trade. Wow, I say. How did you feel when you first saw his handwriting? Muy contenta, she says, with a smile so spontaneous and uncontrived, you'd think their 2-year separation had just that instant ended. They don't have insurance, she says, but then again, they never get sick. All their food is fresh from their garden. She breastfed the babies. They get good milk and cheese from their goats. In the past, she's tried government-sponsored healthcare programs, but she felt kind of ashamed accepting government aid and probably won't be doing it again. Quote, it's nice remembering these things, he says, now that we are all here together, but also it's sad because I remember those left behind on the road. What's your dream, I ask, you know, your eventual dream for your... I have arrived at my dream already, he says. The oldest daughter brings in some vegetables from their garden, okra, big fat peppers. Is she the daughter in school? I'm a junior, she says in perfect English. Her passion is math. She wants to be a math teacher. I mentioned that my daughter is in the throes of quadratic equations. Oh, she says shyly, I love those. You love quadratic equations? I say, I love them, she says. If this isn't the essential American story, I don't know what is. Guy hews out a life out of nothing by working every waking moment with no education, no government help, no external advantages whatsoever, and no ulterior motive. What did he want? A place where his kids could grow up with less fear and more material comforts. Did he get it? Yes, he did. God bless him. The next section is, let us reduce our enemies so we can mock them more easily. The Minuteman Project is kicking off Operation Sovereignty, their, quote, largest operation to date, close quote, with a rally on a narrow strip mall berm in Laredo. It's a rally in the modern American style. Participants, few. Media, many. The Minutemen angrily shout, what do we want? Deport them now! Members of the Union de Trabajadores del Suroeste angrily shout, hey, ho, racist Minutemen got to go. A jaunty Mexican-American in wraparound sunglasses wearing a serape, however you pronounce that, waving a Mexican flag, angrily shouts, who picks your potatoes? Who builds your houses? A Minuteman angrily shouts regarding the Mexican flag guy, he told me to get out of his city. This is my country, man. Everyone's pissed, oppositional, less empathetic and articulate and well-mannered than they would be at any other moment in their actual lives. The media rushes around, sticking their cameras into the face of whoever's behaving most badly at the moment. A bespectacled little dude in a huge cowboy hat says he's running for Congress in Austin. How's it going, I ask. Bad, he says. I don't have any money. Does he have a position on the immigration issue? He does. Borders make a country, and we need a better border, namely a wall. But how do you do that, just, you know, physically? Simple. Alter the border. Cede land to Mexico until the border is a long straight line, then run your wall from here to California. I imagine that ugly map, beautiful border curves of the Rio Grande made computer straight. I step over for a word with the Mexican flag guy. Because of my appearance, white, baseball capped, middle-aged, he mistakes me for a Minuteman until, to prove I'm not a Minuteman, I disparage the Minuteman. We are walking by a light pole, the base of which is exposed, a possible tripping hazard. He points it out, saying that had I been a Minuteman, he would have let me fall on my ass. Nearby, 3 minute women stand in the midday sun with a sign, Mexico's a bad neighbor. The Mexican flag guy taunts them. It's hot in that sun, isn't it? That's what you like about us, right? We don't burn, baby. Which is kind of weird since 2 of the minute women are Hispanic. Presumptive fellow non-burners. Here's the story of how one of these women, Lupe Moreno, became a minute woman. As a teenager, her son had a car accident and ended up partially paralyzed. In the next hospital bed was an illegal who'd broken his arm coming over the wall. Once treated, he ran away. After Lupe's son was released, she started getting nagging letters from the hospital demanding the $100 copay. She found this infuriating. This illegal gets thousands of dollars of treatment free, and they're nagging her? To make matters worse, her son needed a wheelchair, but could only have one free for his first week of the stay. Through her work in social services, Lupe was aware of a special program through which, had her son been illegal, he could have gotten a wheelchair free and kept it indefinitely. You mean undocumented, I say. I call them illegals, she says, because that's what they are, close quote. Next slide. Gentle, dignified man, 1, Minutemen, 0. A cluster of Minutemen are shouting across the berm-defining shrub at a 60-something Mexican-American in a Vietnam baseball cap. If he did fight for this country, as implied by his cap, why isn't he willing to fight for it now by protecting it from illegal invaders? He fires back, I was fighting for this country when you were in Pampers, brother. This country kicked the black man around for hundreds of years, he shouts, and now that the black man has finally stood up for himself, the country is looking for someone new to kick, and its eyes have fallen on the brown man. But the brown man built this country, always working cheap, and is not about to become the whipping boy. No, sir, not at this late stage of the game. The uncontrived passion in his voice is shutting the Minutemen down. But then the Union de Trabajadores del Suroeste people start inadvertently drowning him out with their racist Minuteman got the bullhorns. A certain writer, behaving unprofessionally, sneaks over, tells the bullhorn guys to hold off. This Vietnam guy is really kicking ass. a Union de Trabajadores del Suroeste guy rushes a bullhorn to the Vietnam guy. And soon the Minutemen, discouraged, have drifted away to a distant part of the berm. Quote, "We're farmers, you know," a friend of the Vietnam guy tells me. "Born and raised here in Laredo. We've worked hard all our lives. All this anger, all this aggression." And he waves his hand warily at what's left of the rally. Quote, "What I think is, we're here on this earth to take care of one another. We're here on this earth to take care of one another." Close quote. The next section, in which I am choked. I get a few minutes with Jim Gilchrist, founder of the Minuteman Project. What I want to ask is, why are you guys so mad about everything? Why so scared? Where's the love? Instead, I say, quote, "I've read that you're a Christian. What's the relation of this Minuteman ethic to your Christianity?" Close quote. "Charity is good," he said. "Benevolence is good, but charity begins at home, and their home is Mexico." Close quote. Gilchrist is a likable guy in his 50s who reminds me of the actor who played the mayor in Jaws. He speaks in meandering Stengelese paragraphs. Your mind struggles to summarize them, but they will not yield. Strong passions about something or other keep emitting forth from him in a sideways manner that makes you keep listening, in the same way that seeing a beginner skater fly by carrying a stack of dishes might make you keep watching. He's always saying things like, "I've got him in my crosshairs," or, quote, "He's okay for now. He hasn't crossed me yet. He's making all the right noises," close quote. Or of the late Steve Irwin, quote, "He was probably one of these open border cranks, but I gave him a pass. I liked his show," close quote. Or of an African-American Minuteman in Los Angeles with admiring glee, "That guy just burned an effigy of Osama bin Laden in front of a mosque," close quote. Gilchrist can be seen on YouTube saying of a crowd of chanting protesters at Ground Zero, quote, "This is not the first time I've faced Satan. This will not be the last time," close quote. But in person, he's gentlemanly, timid almost. This is communicated via something in his listening posture, leaning slightly forward, a kind of wincing going on around the eyes. After the rally, Minute people convoy out to Eagle Pass, where the op will begin in earnest. We stop at a convenience store to fuel up. Trying to engage Gilchrist, I roll down the van window and jocularly tell him smoking's a nasty habit. Quote, "Well," he says, "I don't do drugs, I don't drink much, and I've recently given up attempted murder," close quote. At the words "attempted murder," putting a mock crazy expression on his face, he reaches through the van window and fake throttles me around the neck. I have no problem with this. I'm from Chicago. Chicago males often bond via fake kicks to the groin, so I feel I'm getting off easy. Although I also think, one, wow, that was a pretty energetic fake choke, and two, has this guy not undergone media training? We drive 2 hours into the country looking for illegals along the way. In particular, it would seem, for illegals too deaf or stupid to hide when they hear a 12-car convoy approaching. The next section is, no, tell me what you really think. Here are some facts about Minute people, or at least the 8 I had dinner with that night at Skillet's restaurant in Eagle Pass, Texas. Minute people are fun. You can't insult them. They're willing to entertain any point of view. They like to debate. They look stern at first, do a lot of scowling, but behind their eyes, once you get them talking, there's a hurt, docile quality, possibly related to past wrongs done them, a quality I associate with the thunked as kids. Long ago, the world turned on them in some unexpected and unpleasant way, and they are not unreasonably expecting that it could happen again at any moment. They are not unreasonably expecting that it could happen again at any moment. The Barney Fife-ish quality of their bluster recedes immediately upon challenge, and they go soft, and you somehow magically become dad. I announce myself as an Eastern liberal and am thereafter treated like a mini celebrity or lab specimen, a living example of rare species they've heretofore only heard about on Fox. Paradoxically, my opinions seem to matter to them. They're oddly deferential. They listen. When I argue that despite our gun laws, Manhattan is safer than Houston, or assert that, yes, there are working class people in New York City that take me on faith, adjust their arguments accordingly, and seem happy for the correction because it means I was taking their arguments seriously in the first place. I ask if Minutemen ever bring guns on their ops. We all have guns, someone says. We all have guns here, says someone else. This is Texas, says a third someone. Totally legal. Their guns, in fact, are influencing their choice of hotels. They have to be able to bring their weapons inside. Quote, the thing about people from New York, says Shannon, founder of the Texas Minutemen, who has been smiling at me in passing all day in a way that manages to be suspicious, deferential, and welcoming all at once, is they're rude. Close quote. It's the way they talk to you, someone else says. Has he, Shannon, ever been to New York? Ha ha, yeah, right. Like I'm going to go into that crazy place without my guns. They honestly don't go anywhere they can't bring their guns? Nope, the world's too insane. It would be irresponsible to put themselves at that kind of risk. Chicago? Ha! Boston? Please! How about Mexico? Have they ever been over there? The most enthusiastic guffaws yet. Am I kidding? The cartels, they say, have a bounty out on them. 25 grand for any Minuteman. And for Shannon, 50 grand. Shannon's a star, someone says. Being called a star seems to rev Shannon up. He takes the floor, presents a discourse that might be entitled, My Thoughts on Bitches. He has a friend who once lived with two lesbians and slept with them both, together and separately. However, problems developed when this friend unwisely, quote, started hitting one harder than the other, close quote. Shannon has to admit it. Girl-wise, the only thing he really likes is dominating them. There was this one gal, for example, who kept being uncooperative. Finally, she kind of uncooperatively, more or less cooperated. To celebrate his victory, he stole her bra, then hung it from his car antenna. There's nothing like it, he says, like dominating them. Then he emits a phrase so crude, so poetically dense. It combines images of, one, a small furry beast, and two swinging down thingies that I want to get out my notebook and ask him to repeat it, but I chicken out, and the exact wording is lost forever. But suffice to say, what made that particularly furry beast swinging thingy combo so delightful to Shannon was that, although towering over Shannon, it had consented to be dominated by him. Ah, but that's all in the past, he sighs. Of late, he's gotten, quote, some sane wisdom, close quote. He knows what he looks like. These days, if a man says she finds him attractive, he just asks how much it's going to cost him. Or he looks behind him to determine who she's really talking to. This makes me sad. Under the bluster, he seems like a nice guy, a gentle guy, even a doting husband waiting to happen, possibly capable of loving and being loved in return. If only he could just, wait, I think, why are you being such a sucker? Did he or did he not just say the things he just said? Stop trying so hard to be Johnny Compassion. Why is he talking such rude shit? I turn to Leslie, the lone minute woman at the table. Is this guy a misogynist or what? I say. You don't find this offensive? I'm not easily intimidated, she says, laughing. Do I look like I'm easily intimidated? Some National Guardsmen come in and sit nearby, and this gets us on the subject of Iraq. Brian, a smart, articulate Minuteman, originally from Massachusetts, who has traveled all over the world, Brazil, Japan, India, says Fallujah should have been leveled. He sends this out like a blustering trial balloon. Is he nuts, I ask? How many women and children would have required killing? Well, he says that happens once. It doesn't happen again. Hello, I say, are you really saying that? Little kids, old ladies? Well, he says, you order them out first. Come on, I say, think about New Orleans. Come on, I say, think about New Orleans. People in Fallujah are much poorer than that. How do they get out? I mean, what do they rent cars, call taxis? Could you give that order? I don't think you could. I don't think you would. He looks chastened and does a remarkable thing, given that he's arguing with a liberal in front of his people. He reverses position. You're right, he says. I wouldn't. No. Through it all, our Mexican-American waitress, resembling a pretty deli street waif, courtesy of her thick mascara, comes and goes, being spoken gently to by Shannon and the others in the courteous, quasi-military tones favored by the Minute People. Taking another music break. It's pretty hot in here under this light, but I'm enjoying this. I hope someone in the world will too.
Check out the real situation. Nation war against nation. Where did it all begin? When will it end? Well, it seems like total destruction, no solution. There is no use. No one can stop us now. They don't use. Nobody can stop them now. Give them an initiative. Give them a yard to take a mile. Once a minute, twice a time. And everything is just for a while. It feels like total destruction, only solution. And there it is, you. No one can stop them. There ain't no you. No one can stop them now. There ain't no you. No one can stop them now.
So we are reading from George Saunders' piece called The Great Divider, which was written in 2006. So these are all stories from the border, written by one of our best writers here in the United States, back in 2006 for a magazine article. And then when we're done with this, we're going to read 2019 piece by William T. Volman, also at the border. That's called Just Keep Going North. But picking up now again, back in 2006. Lost patrol that can't shoot straight, fails to find ass with both hands. The next morning, we, quote, go out on recon, meaning we walk around the ranch we'll be guarding later tonight. An upbeat guy named Curtis, president of U.S. Border Watch, leads us media around, pointing out evidence of illegals. A tamped-down human-sized nest in some reeds, a fence cut, some garbage, and marking several possible deployment spots using bits of a cow skull he's found. The white bone will be visible later in the moonlight. An irrigation ditch running parallel to the border is a plus. The sound of the illegals waiting in the ditch will serve as a kind of early warning system. We walk the fence line. The neighboring rancher isn't on board, so the op will be confined to about a 300-yard stretch of this ranch. Quote, we're in a real rat race here, Curtis says on his cell as we start back to the cars. The media's pounding us, close quote. We, media, look around, puzzled. We're not pounding anybody. We're just walking quietly behind Curtis, having our little media thoughts. We take a shortcut back through a grove of mesquite. Shannon says this reminds him of a forest near Knights of Pythias, the Knights of Pythias home, where he was sent to live during his parents' divorce. Soon, it becomes clear we're lost. The cars can't be more than 100 yards away, but we don't seem to be getting any closer. Curtis suggests somebody send a radio message to base camp, i.e. the car, see if somebody can honk a horn or something. Radio contact proves problematic. From the front of the group, some grumbling. Ahead is a creek. There's much concern, shouted optimization instructions, extended hands, some awkward scrambling up the opposite muddy slope. Good-humored post-crossing comparisons of soaked pants legs, media and minute persons united as one. Then the group bunches up. Again, a surprise. There's a barbed wire fence ahead, literally 5 feet from the lip of the creek. And as the front of the group struggles through the fence, coats snagging on barbed wire, on mesquite branches, raindrops plopping off trees, a cry goes up. Geez, another fence! Besides this one? Yes, yes, a whole other fence. We are like caught between these two improbably close together, non-parallel fences in a forest no cow could ever enter. How odd. What a perverse rancher. Makes you kind of respect the illegals, a minute person says sweetly. Suddenly, shouts of consternation from the front of the group, which has freed itself from the two-fence trap, only to find, "What do you got?" Curtis shouts. It appears there's a second creek, which may even qualify as a small, deep river beyond this second fence, which is proving even stouter and more gnarly than the first. Jesus, where the hell are we? Who designed this freaking ranch? Escher? Quote, "I thought all y'all media were supposed to be neutral," smirks Shannon. "Not so neutral now, are you?" This is so nutty as to be hilarious. "We're being neutral," I say, "by not making fun of you." "Attention all units," Curtis cries out to those of us still on this side of River 2. "If you have not crossed the ravine yet, do not cross. I repeat, do not cross." I can see the headline now, if anyone escapes to write it. Minutemen die of starvation in tiny thicket, comically close to own cars. A photographer with bad knees goes down, is lifted to his feet by Brian, the guy who last night advocated the annihilation of Fallujah, whose face, as he goes to the photographer's aid, is transformed by a look of sudden, radiant concern. In time, as in a beautiful dream, we arrive back at the cars. Is our leadership crushed, humiliated, bitterly angry, ordering us not to tell anyone? On the contrary, our leaders are cheerful, triumphant, hyped with victory, as if this getting lost never happened. Or maybe as if, having been closely involved with embarrassing debacles all their lives, they have learned an excellent coping strategy. Deny, smile, move on. Through my mind runs the phrase, "Shows good spirit." The next section is called, "With Guns, It's Not So Funny." At dusk, the same good-spirited crew. Oh, hang on, I got to respond to this. That nearly met its doom in the lost forest. Sorry, got to take care of something here. That's the phone that's affecting us. Boy, we're at an hour on this, and we haven't even gotten to the other story yet, which might be longer. With Guns, It's Not So Funny. At dusk, the same good-spirited crew that nearly met its doom in the land of infinite fences arrives back at the ranch, heavily armed. We, media, are kind of shocked into silence at the extent of the armament. Every minute man's got at least a shotgun, a rifle, or a machine gun-looking semi-automatic weapon. My team leader, Art, a fearsome biker-looking dude, 6'1", 250, shaved-headed, bearded, tattooed, who is, in fact, a biker, but is also a troubleshooter for a fiber-optic network and a member of Mensa, has, in addition to his semi-automatic, a 45 down each pants leg, a long, jagged knife he calls his Arkansas toothpick, and a two-shot Derringer designed to fire shotgun shells. I tell him that because I'm a liberal and he's so large, I expect that if there's trouble, he will carry me to safety. He gives me a look I would describe as the ornery eye twinkle of possible friendship, reminding me of my childhood friend Kay, who was equally happy explicating the art of war or driving his head through a wall. Darkness falls, the moon comes up. Our team advances into the brush through a kind of willful mass hypnosis aided by all this wishful costuming. Things suddenly go very Vietnam, and a tense, watchful quiet falls over the group. It's scary, partly because we're making it scary, and partly because one, real illegals really do cross here, led by real members of the real smuggling cartels, and two, these are real guns. Suddenly, weirdly, I find my eyes tearing up. How many times, through the long centuries of life on Earth, has one group of men sneaked armed into the woods, hoping to surprise a second group not expecting them? And where has this gotten us? I feel sad for whomever we might catch, some little family even now timidly approaching in the dark, and sad for the Minutemen, plodding forward like ghosts doomed to hunt that which causes them anxiety through all eternity. We spread out in the dark, three teams of 3 minute people each, about 100 yards between each group. This is the total extent of Operation Sovereignty. 9 guys, 4 media, along a few 100 yards of border on one small ranch in the huge state of Texas. A tiny patch of catcher in 1,000 miles of rye. Our team may surprise you. Our team takes up its position in some long grass besieged by bugs. I wish we could sit over there on that less buggish dirt road, but Art has positioned us here, and something in me is cheerfully rising to the faux military discipline. Soon, the sky is crossed with parallel rivers of low, milky stars. Scott's from Houston, the founder of the Texas militia. He's just out here getting some experience points, he says. This is his first op. He can only stay a week. What with work, graphic design, and his militia stuff, 4 membership applications at home waiting to be processed, he's super busy. Plus, of course, he's got Ren Faire coming up. Ren Faire? I say. Renaissance Faire, he says. Do you do that? I say. He does. He does the whole deal. He's got a $1,200 suit of leather armor, does an English accent, but no, has not developed a role play, seeing as how he is merely a playtron, and playtrons are not paid to interact with patrons, i.e. mundanes. Our third team member, Lance, so far known to me only as an angry, frustrated voice, piping up now and then to express a sense that everything is all fucked up and being orchestrated by sinister forces from far away, is sitting under a tree. I join him there, out of the moonlight, in what in daytime would be shade. He recently married a Russian woman he met online, he says. For many years, he says he was a... The next bit is unintelligible or impossible. I ask him to repeat. No, I've heard right. For many years, he was a dancer with the Houston Ballet. He and his wife... Sorry, of course, you wouldn't know it to look at me now, he said. He and his wife appeared on a Ricky Lake segment on Russian mail order brides. He didn't do what so many guys seeking Russian brides do, he says, i.e. go to a mass meet and greet in some St. Petersburg hotel. His wife is from a small town, and he went there to meet her, and they really connected from the heart. She's a great lady, and they're so happy together. She's just, he shakes his head, not quite believing his good fortune. When he talks about his wife, the paranoid quality of his political discourse drops away, and he becomes relaxed and confident. He owns a construction company, but is thinking of doing something different with his life, making some investments. He's thinking, in fact, of buying the Ren Faire in Houston. I'm a little confused. Does he know that Scott also is involved with Ren Faire? Quote, sure, that's how we met, he says. Scott's in the Torturers Guild, close quote. We wait and wait for some Mexicans to blunder over the border and to plop into the irrigation ditch. But nobody comes. Nearly the death of some guy named Carl. Waiting implies an eventual end to waiting, which produces dramatic structure. Somebody radios, Team 2, a car is approaching your position. A car is indeed approaching. Art's whispering on the radio, is it one of ours? Is it? Anybody read me? No answer. Quote, you media take cover around the corner, he says. The corner is like behind those trees 10 feet away. I take cover by walking over, standing there, feeling a little stupid. Scott drops to one knee, raises his shotgun. Lance goes down on his belly, sights down the barrel of his semi-automatic. Our team suddenly looks like a Baghdad checkpoint. I'm thinking, hold on now, isn't this probably a rancher, a lost rancher, a lost tipsy guest of a rancher? The car, a white Oldsmobile, appears slowly, slowly, just the way a drug smuggler or cartel pickup car would. It seems to pause as it passes. Somebody hisses. Did he just drop something? Lance and Scott rush forward to have a look at the dropped thing. What is it, drugs? A bag of narcotics? Negative. It's just a plastic bag they hadn't noticed before. A call comes from Team 1 down the line. The vehicle was Carl. This makes us, Team 2, very angry. That's stupid, Carl. Why the hell didn't Carl radio? Who is Carl anyway? How many ops has he done? Scott barks, Carl better pull head out of rear, or next time he's going to get his car filled with lead. No, no, Art says. No free fire permitted. Don't get all. The Minutemen cannot detain an illegal. They cannot harass. All they can do is call the Border Patrol. So why the guns? They don't, they say, want to be overrun by the cartel. Has a Minuteman ever been shot or shot at by the cartel? No. But conceptualizing the cartel dudes as Scarfacean monsters, the Minutemen come out armed to meet them in the night and thereby rev themselves up. And yet there's no training. Art is the most experienced Minuteman on our team. Lance and Scott are both first timers. So, a prediction. Eventually, somebody's going to get shot. It may be a Minuteman. It may be a cartel dude. It may be some little kid standing scared at the back of a group of immigrants. But eventually, I tell Art, all this tension and drama is going to lead to something tragic. You don't come into my house, man, Art says. This isn't your house, I say. Oh, sure it is, he says. This is my country. Your house is your house, I say. This is some dude's ranch.